All's my life I has to fight. All's my life I hard times like yeah, bad trips like yeah. Nazareth, you got us, then we gon' be alright. And when I wake up, I recognize you looking at me for the pay cut. Bahamas, I be looking at you from the face down. One Mac 11, even room with the bass down. Scheming, and let me tell you about my life. Painkillers only put me in a twilight. We're pretty, and it's the highlight. I tell my mama I love her, but this what I like. Lord knows, 20 of them in my Chevy. Tell them all to come and get me, reaping everything I sow. So my karma come in heaven, no preliminary hearings on my record. I'm a mother, silence for the record. Tell the world I know it's too late. Boys and girls, I think I've
Let's hop into this thing, and just to quickly give a shout out to everyone tuning in, we got Olivia in Austin, Texas, Elijah in Atlanta, Natalie in Ontario, Cameron in Athens, Georgia, Sharon in Phoenix, Arizona, Tammy in Kansas, Brian in Phoenix, bringing up the majority today, and Kubra in Istanbul. Let's do it. What is up, everyone? This is Alex Lieberman, co-founder and CEO of Morning Brew, coming to you with another edition of my CMO series, where I help you make smarter decisions as a marketer by interviewing the smartest marketers in the world. Few housekeeping items. As always, this is not an interview. It is a conversation. We want to make this collaborative. So if you have questions for our guest, please add them in the comments or reply on Twitter or Periscope. We will try to get to as many as we can. Second, if you aren't subscribed to Marketing Brew, it is not biased at all. The best email newsletter for folks working in marketing in the world, 3 days a week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, we send out Marketing Brew, and it is written in the tone and voice Morning Brew subscribers have come to love. Now, for today's guest, Frank Cooper is the Global Chief Marketing Officer of BlackRock. BlackRock is the world's largest asset manager with $7.4 trillion in assets under management. For people that don't have a reference point, the reference point is that is a shit ton of money. As global CMO, Mr. Cooper is responsible for shaping BlackRock's global brand and marketing strategy for institutional and retail clients, including overseeing all digital marketing, branding, and research and insights functions at the firm. Prior to BlackRock, Mr. Cooper was CMO and Chief Creative Officer at BuzzFeed, CMO of Global Consumer Engagement for PepsiCo's Global Beverage Group, and he also served as a senior executive at both Motown and Def Jam. Without further ado, Frank, you ready to do this?
Let's do it.
Okay, let's get the quick Frank story. So you're CMO of BlackRock now, but let's get a quick history lesson on your career.
So quick history lesson, and I'll try to do this in a minute or so. I actually started off as a lawyer. Went to Harvard Law School, thought I was going to teach constitutional law, had an epiphany, which we could talk about, decided that I wanted to connect to entertainment and technology. Practiced for a very short time, and I went into Motown Records, Motown got bought by Polygram. I then went into Def Jam Records. Def Jam later got bought by Polygram. But it was an incredible experience because I basically saw two of the most important urban music labels in the world at the critical points in their trajectory. I left there. I ultimately founded a company called Urban Box Office, UBO.com. That was my first foray into kind of really being an entrepreneur and all that entails. Eventually went from there to AOL for a short period, and then got a call from a friend who connected me to Pepsi. Again, knew nothing about consumer goods, consumer packaged goods, he saw something in me and the connection that that I couldn't see. And I ended up spending 12 years at Pepsi, rising through the ranks and doing a wide variety of things across multiple brands.
What was your first role at Pepsi?
My first role at Pepsi was strategy, and part of what I did is oversee multicultural marketing and started to build out the digital department. And at that time, the digital department was still fairly nascent at Pepsi. And so so that was my responsibility. And I moved from there. I ran all of retail. And then from there, I took over the Mountain Dew brand, really all the flavored soft drink brands. And then I took over the entire soft drink portfolio, including Pepsi, et cetera, and then became CMO from there. And so it was a pretty interesting rise from, you know, strategy on the side to kind of running the most important brand, multi-billion dollar brands for the company.
Wild.
Yeah.
And then after Pepsi.
Yeah. And so after Pepsi, so I was at Pepsi and Jonah Peretti was on my digital advisory board at Pepsi. And we used to do these tours over to Silicon Valley, and I would bring people there, you know, senior executives. And a lot of people were talking about Jonah Peretti and BuzzFeed. And they're like, well, this thing is going to be, you know, it's going to be massive. And I started talking to Jonah about it, and he's like, it's a rocket ship, jump on. Yeah. And honestly, Alex, I felt like at that time, I loved Pepsi, but I felt like what I was doing in the digital space was still at the margins of what was the core operating model of the company. And right. So I wanted to jump in the heart of it. That's why I went into BuzzFeed, and it was a great run. You know, we ended up getting the most innovative company in the world by Fast Company, and we did Tasty, and it became a large, you know, food network. It was a great run. Then I got a strange call from a friend from BlackRock, and actually got a call from a recruiter first, and I said, like, I don't really do financial services. It's not kind of what I do. You know what I mean? You know, and no disdain for it, but I know nothing about it. Number one, and number two, I consider myself more of a cultural marketer, and as a cultural marketer, I'm likely to have compliance knock on my door every single day. you know, as I'm pushing the boundaries, and so I'm like, yeah. It probably makes no sense. So I recommended some other people, and then a good friend, a guy named Jonathan McBride, he called me up, and Jonathan was the director of presidential personnel under Obama, and so we had known each other from that, that situation, and he called me. He said, "Coop, you're messing up." Yeah, I said, "Well, why am I messing up? You know, I don't do financial services." He said, "You're messing up because we are at this inflection point, and everything they're talking about, it just sounds like you. We're talking about building a brand that actually connects to people broadly. Larry Fink is talking about purpose. They want to stand up a digital, not only department, they want to make the entire company, you know, more digital and make digital the new center of gravity for the company. It just sounds like you. You should come in and at least talk to a few people." And I did, and you know, 4.5 years later, I'm still here, and it's been a fascinating journey. But the through line to this, Alex, because it sounds like a random walk through life, and some of it is random, some of it is serendipity, some of it is random chance, some of it, you know, it's got by grace, you know. But a lot of it is this. Early in my career, an attorney said to me that, "Hey, whatever you do, take your personal interests, the things that actually give you energy in your personal life, connect it to your professional life. If you don't do it, you'll see that go to the wayside over time, and it'll be almost impossible to have a sense of fulfillment in your job. But if you connect it early in your career, why not do it now? I guarantee you, you will find your way through different positions, different jobs, and you'll feel fulfilled through all of it." And that's kind of what I did. And you know, you look at something like Motown and Def Jam, and you say, "Well, what relationship does that have to, say, a BuzzFeed?" It's actually very connected. You know, all three of them are saying, here's a way for us to connect to what some people would consider the other. You know, Motown was all about assimilation of Black culture into mainstream culture. Def Jam was about remaining true to yourself. And so whether you were Amy in Scarsdale or John in Brownsville, you're going to feel like, you know what, I know how to overcome struggle by integrating into this culture. You know, BuzzFeed was about taking marginalized people who are historically marginalized and putting them on center stage. A lot of connection points there. And for me, I've carried all these lessons from job to job, industry to industry, and I'm amazed by the overlap that I see in it.
So just to push on that a little bit more, where does a Mountain Dew factor into that? Or where does BlackRock and just like the business of money factor into that?
Yeah. So Mountain Dew was crazy, right? Because, you know, when I got called in, a woman named Dawn Hudson was president of Pepsi-Cola at the time. And she called me in, Pepsi-Cola North America. And she called me in, and she was fantastic to me. She was one of the people, you know, people who help you along through your life and career, and for no explicable reason. And so she calls me and says, "Hey, you know what? I want you to run the Mountain Dew brand. It's declined 2.5% last year. I want you to jump in. And I was like, wait, Mountain Dew. And for those who don't know Mountain Dew, Mountain Dew is a euphemism for moonshine because it was made in the hills of Tennessee. Its core audience is in the South and Midwest. It's heavy into NASCAR, but deep, raw NASCAR, not the polished NASCAR. And I was like, well, I don't know. And by the way, the logo, the first logo was a hillbilly with a shotgun running toward a shed. Like, that's the first logo of Mountain Dew. So I'm like, okay, probably doesn't seem like it's the right brand for me, but you say it is. What I found was this, Mountain Dew, when you got beneath the surface of that particular kind of specific cultural expression, you got beneath the surface, here's what it stood for. It stood for DIY, do it yourself. It stood for operate outside the mainstream. You can't get it from the mainstream, operate outside the mainstream. And it stood for remain true to yourself. And that was true from its founding to today. And so I said, I saw it as a great opportunity. I said, well, where is that being expressed today? You know, how's that manifesting itself? And I saw it in street boarding, you know, street skateboard. I saw it in independent art. And so we started Green Label Sound. You know, I saw it in graffiti. And we started building, we built this platform called Green Label, which became art, sound, sports. And we just supported independent people who wanted to do it themselves, remain true to themselves, and operate outside the mainstream. And so that became the connection point. You know, you fast forward to BuzzFeed, it's not so different. You know, it might be a different set of people, different cultural segment, but the same sensibility. And Alex, what I found is that what the cry of social media, the internet, and people in general is that I want to be seen and I want to feel like I have an opportunity to grow and make it. And so if I can't get it through the standard system, I'm looking for other means to help me. Who's going to help me? And those who help me, I'm down with. Those who don't help me, I'm not down with. And it's simple as that.
Yeah. No, it's so interesting because you've been able to excel throughout your career, being in incredibly different spaces from a product perspective, not from a cultural segment perspective, but from a product perspective. Like, you went into Pepsi, I would assume you weren't a CPG expert. You went into BuzzFeed, you weren't necessarily an online media expert. You went into BlackRock, you weren't necessarily an asset management expert. But you've been able to crush it in all these roles. Is it because of your natural tilt towards thinking about culture and people from the outset in your roles? Like, what has made you good, given you haven't been a market expert from a product perspective in any of these roles when you start?
You know, the first thing that I've done is I looked for industries that are undergoing massive change. And I look for leaders who actually want to lead that change. Because in any of those examples you gave, if things were static, if people felt like, hey, we're going to see incremental change over the next 10 years, I would fail miserably. Because every idea I would come in with, they were like, hey, that's not how it's done. You know, every time I would come in with something from left field, they were like, no, we have a formula, a pattern for success. Why would you disturb that? You know, so I look for change. And that's where I thrive. So that's number one. The second thing is that I try to understand the economics of the industry. The first thing I do when I come in, before I even get to culture, I just try to understand the economics of the industry. How is money made today? And then where are the fault lines? Like, where are the structural gaps? Where are the pressure points? And I just try to do it at a very high level. Who's making money? How are they making it? Why? And what seems to be changing? But when I think about change, I start from the outside in, and I'm looking at culture, people. You know, how are people thinking about it? Not just as consumers. Just how do they think about the brand? You know, what are they, what's giving them a source of connection to the company? What are they sharing? You know, what's making, you know, what's part of their kind of cultural mix? And then I work back to the industry, and then I work back to the company. That's typically how I do it. I work that triangle. And to me, it's like a triangle of trust.
Yeah.
Culture first, empathy, you know, industry second, capability, company third, authenticity. That's kind of what I'm working.
It's really interesting because in all of my conversations with CMOs over the last several months on this show, one thing that I haven't heard, which you just touched on, is kind of like the economics of the industry. and you use the language of understanding the fault lines. And I think it's really interesting because I think a lot of people, when they think about a CMO, my assumption of the preconceived notions of the CMO is it's someone who comes in, who thinks about things at the highest brand level, who is kind of this creative visionary who comes up with incredible long-term campaigns, but isn't necessarily connected to the mechanics of the business and the economics of the business. And so I think it's a really interesting detail that you included.
And Alex, if you don't do that in marketing, I promise you, you will lose. You'll be at best looking on the outside of the C-suite. If you get into the C-suite, people will look at you as kind of marginal. To me, marketing really is about driving profitable growth for the company. And what levers can you pull to do it? And I feel like we're at an amazing time because it's art and science coming together for the first time. And many marketers choose one or the other camp. Some say I'm going to be like Mad Men and I want to tell the stories. I want to be super creative and it's great. And I love that piece of it. Some say I want to be the mad scientist. It's performance marketing. I'm bottom of the funnel. I'm about transactions. This is stuff that really matters. All that other stuff is noise. And what I'm seeing is that those who are able to bring it together and right now they're calling them hybrid marketers. I think pretty soon it's going to be called marketers. those who can bring that together, that's real power. I mean, that's like, you don't have to be a data scientist to understand that data is important and to value the data and to be a part of that system and feedback loop. You don't have to be a creator and a storyteller in order to craft the data in a way that a creator can understand it. It's that kind of hybrid and working together. If you can build teams like that, that is a massive unlock. And it's one of the reasons why I'm so excited today as a marketer, because I think the marriage of art and science is real for the first time in a long time.
100%. And, I think the best way to actually talk about the application of this is using BlackRock as a case study, because I feel like you are in the middle, I don't know what inning you would say you're in, of this massive change of a massive company where you have to balance like the long-term change in narrative that you're trying to drive for it, like an old traditional brand. But at the same time, I would assume that there's also aspects of short-term performance and driving business results that you also need to constantly be keeping in the back of your mind. So we're making you Professor Cooper right now. And I want you to walk us through what is your definition of success within your role within BlackRock, and how do you think about driving that success?
Yeah, so my definition of success, and it's the first thing I said when I walked into the building and presented to BlackRock as a whole. My definition of success is that marketing is consistently driving profitable growth for the company, not as sales enablement. We can help sales, and we should do that, but can we actually create demand? Can we scale that demand? Can we deepen relationships with clients? That to me is success. And we measure it by, brand acquisition and relationships, NPS usually on the last part. That's simple. And I keep it that simple. There's a bunch of stuff underneath it, but that's how I measure the success.
Got it. And what is, you talk about every one of your roles, there being similarities in the roles. And in my mind, the way that you've talked about it is kind of these two similarities. One is being involved in businesses that sit at like a really interesting point in culture and serving kind of like the fringes of culture. And then I think the second that you talk about is this idea of change. And every business you've worked in, it's going through some very significant change that you are helping to enact. What is the change that's happening at BlackRock?
So it's a great question. The change that's happening at BlackRock, and it's not just BlackRock, the change that's happening in financial services is that people have awakened to the fact that financial services, whether it's a bank, an investment bank, an asset manager, is shaping their lives in fundamental ways. They're like, wow, you know what? When I look at my local economy, when I look at the planet, when I look at inequality or equality, these institutions are playing a role, and they're getting a better understanding of that. And so I think that to me was the most fundamental shift that happened across the industry, and it did something that no asset manager had to do previously. It actually made them come into the light. And so BlackRock, as the largest asset manager, suddenly, after 30 years of just, you know, driving enormous success, I mean, and just really focusing exclusively on clients and being humble and quiet, suddenly it's in the public eye. And you have a choice. You can either remain silent and hope that things go away, or step into the void yourself. What they found is, and what we found is that the nature abhors the vacuum, right? What happens, other people fill that vacuum with their own narrative. And so the pressure that we suddenly found ourselves with is that, wow, we need to state who we are and what we do. And that's kind of really where we started. My push was, we need to go deeper than that. Before we state who we are and what we do, we need to state, why do we even exist in society? Like, profits, we got to make profits. We have to generate returns for clients. But why do we exist in society? And that becomes the compass for everything else. For me, that was the biggest step forward. The second thing is this. People started realizing that, you know, when they saw everyone wants to be a billionaire, and you know, and that's a great thing. And I'm certainly not somebody who's saying being a billionaire is a bad thing. I'm not, but I would love to be one. It'd be great. However, people have seen billionaires that are miserable, many of them. And they come to this realization that, wow, our relationship with money is deeper than a specific amount. It's deeper. And we started to get hints of it by how we earn our money. People want to earn it in a certain way. We started to get a sense of it, how we spend it. People want to have symbols that kind of attach to them. But now we're in the mode of saving and investing. You know, and what does that say about you and your life and your relationship with money and how that affects your values? That's where we are now. And that's a fundamental shift in the industry that I think for some evokes fear, but for others, I include myself in this, it's an amazing challenge that if we get it right, I think you open up a whole new, you open up new opportunities for new segments of people across the world.
Totally. And, you know, just to go a little bit deeper in kind of digging into the why, you know, what my assumption about your assumption is that the why of BlackRock hasn't changed. It just hasn't actually been brought to the fore like it should be. Do you think a big reason that you're focusing on kind of like this narrative around society's relationship with money and having a well relationship with money is from the standpoint of a business change in BlackRock traditionally being a company that is servicing institutions and thinking more about servicing individual consumers, or like on the retail side? Or is it more just the type of thing that, irrespective of who BlackRock's customers are, it is going to be increasingly important to connect this massive asset manager to human beings, given in any way, like BlackRock is serving human beings?
That's the second point, is that BlackRock is serving human beings. And you know, I feel like sometimes we all get caught up in the B2B, B2C, B2B, yeah, to C distinction. Actually don't get caught up in it at all, because at the end of the day, if you look at the system, at the end of the day, you're serving human beings, even if you're serving the intermediary. But ultimately, we're serving that end investor, that person who's trying to save, the pensioner who wants to retire with dignity, the employee, yep, with 401k. That's who we're serving, you know, even though we go through the intermediary. And Alex, the most fascinating thing that I've seen about this kind of wave of activism and citizen engagement is a much deeper understanding of the system. Like, the attacks and the protests and the hopes are no longer tied to one action. You know,
right,
there's complaints about and grievances about one action, but they're looking back past that one action and say, what is the system, you know, behind it that's driving it? And once you start have that kind of systems thinking, it doesn't matter if you're the manufacturer, the distributor, or the retailer. You're part of that system and you're driving it, and you have some responsibility and obligation there. The second thing is this: we are just uniquely situated, you know, given the amount of assets that we manage, to make change. You know, when we announced, and Larry Fink in his CEO letter in January 14th of this year announced that we're going to make sustainability our standard. We believe that climate risk is investment risk. It led to an industry shift. It accelerated what was already happening. But our size and influence allowed us to help accelerate that toward a positive conclusion. I believe we have an obligation to do that. And then the last thing is this: if you can help, why would you not help? Regardless of the position that you're in, you know, like call yourself B2B, B2C, manufacturer, distributor, retail, doesn't really matter. If you can help, if you can contribute in a positive way, make a positive contribution, why would you not do that? And you can do it for selfish reasons, you know, which is it'll enhance my reputation and my brand. But I think it should be core to who you are as a company and a core sense of purpose. And I think many employees will celebrate you for that. Your suppliers will celebrate you for that. The community will celebrate you for that.
Yeah, I mean, there's so much in what you just said. I want to for a second get your thoughts on what is the guidance that you provide to your team, to the marketing function at BlackRock, in how marketers should be thinking about marketing around all of the important all these important cultural moments, from BLM to the election to like what is the guidance you provide your marketers? Because I'm sure a lot of your marketers come to you feeling uncertain and anxious, for no reason other than there is not a clear right answer, other than maybe the right answer is doing what a good human would do.
Right. It's tough, I'll tell you. But what I say is, first, know yourself. You know, you have to know who you are, what you stand for, what's important for you, what are your values. And I'm saying that both on an individual level, but I'm also saying that on a brand level.
Yeah.
You know yourself. The second thing is, you can't parachute into any cultural segment or cultural issue. Most dangerous thing you can do is parachute in either as a hero or even as an observer. Don't do it. You know, you have to be a part of it. And you have to be more of a giver than a taker. But you have to be part of it, because everyone in any cultural segment, they understand the nuances. You know, if you're a cycler, you know, and you're really into cycling, you'll know the clips on the pedals, you'll know what kind of brakes someone has, you'll know what kind of tires, and you'll know all the nuances. Same thing in the culture. People know if you don't know.
Yeah, you can smell bullshit.
You can smell it a mile away, and you inevitably you will make a mistake, inevitably. But if you're in the culture and you've been contributing and you are really a citizen as well as a marketer within that cultural segment, you're allowed to make mistakes, because everyone makes mistakes, but they know that you're in it for the long haul, that you're part of who they are, that you have the same value system, that you have the same worldview, you know, that you are sharing the same symbols, you know, that, you know, the give and take of stories is happening, that you're giving more than you're taking. That's a big part of it. So know yourself, be a true part of the culture, so that you understand the history of it and understand the nuances of it. But then there's a third thing. You have to figure out what role you want to play within culture. And again, I think this is a dramatic shift that's happened over the years. Most brands, they play a role as observer or sponsor. And I say this having been one of the big sponsors. You know, when I was at Pepsi, we sponsored the Super Bowl. And the one thing that annoyed me greatly was that if you polled people and you said, you know, who's the sponsor of the halftime show? It was long ago. I think it's changed since.
I wouldn't be able to answer.
They'll be like, oh, it's a Coke, it's a Pepsi, 50-50. It would know. So you spend all the money, you're like, okay, what's going on? It's changed, actually, and for good reason. I think people actually know it's the Pepsi halftime show. But what it awakened me to was this, is that being a sponsor gets you part of the way there, creates some awareness, but it doesn't create connection. What creates real connection is when you actually curate, you help sort out the noise for people and put something in front of them that they really enjoy, or you create. So my push is to become more of a curator brand and a creator brand than a sponsor, because it deepens the connection. It demonstrates you're deep into the culture. You understand the nuances. The curation piece is more sharing and giving. The creating piece is shows your ingenuity and your innovativeness. And so that's the last part, the role in culture that a brand can play. I try to push my marketers toward that.
Yeah, and I think the analogy that you gave about, you know, parachuting into moments in culture is such a spot on one, because I think at the end of the day, part of it is that they're not moments, they're always existing and evolving narratives. And it almost reminds me of, like, you know, the bandwagon fan of a sports team. No one likes that bandwagon fan. You are with it through thick and thin from beginning to end. So I love that. And I think it's a great way to, again, articulate it and make it memorable for your team. I want to focus on just the kind of the state of the BlackRock brand right now. And then what I want to do is take some questions from the audience for the remainder of the conversation. So if you have any questions for Frank, now is the perfect time to put them in the comments or reply on Twitter. And we're going to try to get to as many of them as we can. I brought up before, I wasn't sure what inning you're in the evolution of BlackRock and the change that's occurring. What inning would you say you're in?
I'd say we're in the third inning, top of the third. You know, we're just getting started. A lot of things that we did recently were foundational. You know, things like, you know, building a data infrastructure, getting data governance, so that we're ingesting all the data in one place and we can actually map consumer journeys. You know, that's foundational. Understanding what is our brand, you know, how many brands do we even have? So building a brand architecture, a lot of it was foundational. So that to me is like inning one. Inning two was getting the people in place, you know, getting the best talent that I could find in place. And I feel like we've brought in some extraordinary people to run, you know, different parts of the marketing function. And then the next thing is now making it scale within the company. You know, it's one of the hardest things that I experienced when I first came here, and I never had to do this at least in a long time.
Yeah.
If you're at Pepsi, if you're at BuzzFeed, if you're at a music label, you know, the language that you're talking in terms of brand, in terms of connection, in terms of culture, you know, you're far advanced in that language. If you're in an operating company, you know, one that has not had to lean heavily on the brand before, you actually have to break it down in a way that demonstrates a really deep understanding of it. It made me so much of a better marketer actually by doing it. And so, you know, things like I realized I had to explain, like, so what is a brand? Like, what really is it? What value does it really create? But having gone through that, it led me to another realization, which is this whole separation of brand and reputation is a false separation. Today, people are going to look behind the commercial aspects of the brand to say, what is the company doing? What are its labor practices? You know, what are they doing within culture? What are their values? And so, but I would not have gotten there, but for the kind of step back and look at a deep look at what is a brand. So that was the second part of it, the talent. But you know, the key thing for me, and the reason I think we're still early, is getting, making sure marketing is not seen as a separate function that can accelerate other parts of the organization. I need marketing to be seen as it's actually core to the operating model of the business. It's a core engine. It's not designed to throw sizzle, you know, onto the grill, gasoline onto the fire. It should be sitting at the heart of all of it.
How do you do that? How do you pull that off?
You know what? Honestly, it's a lot of conversation with people and having the ability to listen with the intent to understand, like listen to people, like what are they really trying to accomplish, and then deciding how can marketing fit within it. What I've tried to do is kind of break the myths, because and I'll come in early with all the myths. I was like, so I know you want to hear a tagline and see a commercial or a video. I know you want to see, you know, someone in the video. We're doing none of it, none of that. And then people are actually disappointed, you know, because they're like, oh, isn't that the fun part of marketing?
Yeah,
we're doing none of it because that's not what generates profitable growth. Here's what generates profitable growth, and then I'll work from there. But then I listen a lot. Like, I can apply my orthodoxy. I can come, you know, I can say, here's what we did at Pepsi. Here's what we did at BuzzFeed. To me, that doesn't work. What I try to do is understand what is each business leader trying to accomplish, and then demonstrate that we can fit into on that core model. You want to understand the people that you're interacting with better, right? You want to deepen the relationships. Got it. Here's the ways that you can actually do that.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and I feel like that is such a transferable way of thinking that isn't just specific to marketing. It's just like actually listening to people
And it's like, you know, the old adage of you have 2 ears and one mouth, like actually listening to people and listening for the purpose of like internalizing and understanding in order to be more educated in how you say the things that you are going to say. Like, that's not just a marketing thing. That's like a being a smart professional thing.
I agree with it totally. You know, and Alex, a lot of people will say, no, but I do listen. You know, I wait till someone finishes, you know, and I heard them. But oftentimes, even I do this, sometimes I try to fight against it. You're thinking about what you might say next. You know, you're thinking about what point you want to make. You're thinking about how to counter it. But listening with the intent to understand is just really being fully present, fully engaged. And it changes the way you ask questions. You know, suddenly you ask questions in a much more humble way. You know, you're not asking the questions like an attorney, like I'm trying to set you up and I'm going to get the answer that I want. You're asking with the intent to understand.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, we're going to hop into a few questions and then we're going to finish this thing with a little rapid fire. And then we're going to let you be on your way because you've been super generous with your time. The first question is from Sarah Teich. Sarah asked, understanding a brand's mission and purpose is continuous work, but how do you get at the true reason for being?
Yeah, it's a great question, Sarah. And look, it's continuous work for sure. But to me, the most important thing is purpose is not invented, it's discovered. It's more of an archaeological dig than it is kind of this creative brainstorm. And so at least what we did at BlackRock, you know, we decided that our first step is we're going to start from the inside. We interviewed all the founders. We interviewed customers. We interviewed employees at every level, every function, every region. We held a 3-day online event where we just talked about purpose and people told stories. Because, you know, having people tell actual stories is often the best way to tease out purpose. And we ran an algorithm underneath it to see what themes and words were popping. And much of our purpose statement came from those conversations. But it was an archaeological dig. And then you have to find out, like, what is really true? What are you willing to back up and sacrifice? Because there will be a point at which you will have to decide to lean into your purpose at the expense of something. It will happen. And that will tell people whether you're true or not. And that may be the most critical part. There's a second component to all this, though. Putting your purpose up on the wall is almost counterproductive. I remember walking into a well-known technology company, a firm, and I won't say which one it is. And this was years ago, and I walked in, and I was like, oh my God, this is so amazing. You know, on the walls, they have these beautiful phrases that were part of their purpose statement and their mission, and they were just well done, they were artistic. And guess what? They didn't live up to any of them.
You know? Yep.
At least most of them. And people quickly found out, and it became a problem. And so knowing that actions are more important than words, you have to get employees to find an emotional connection to the purpose of the company. It's the only way it actually can be sustained. And so what we did is, how do you do that? We basically said, each employee has to go on a personal journey and go deep and find out what energizes them, what creates a sense of fulfillment for them, and then connect that to their experience at BlackRock. So we developed a workbook for that. It's a bunch of ways to do it. The simplest way, again, stories. If you think back the stories where you had some personal interaction and it actually gave you a sense of a feeling of fulfillment, that's the unlock. And by the way, it's not that you like to ski. It's not that you like to hike. It's not that you like to play basketball. You know, those will come out first. It always has something to do with people and the way you interact with people.
Yeah, that's amazing. And, you know, I think that one of the themes of this CMO series and all the conversations I've had is just like the impact of storytelling, but it's also, there's a difference between saying the importance of stories, but also having story and great storytelling sit at the heart of what you do. I think that was an extraordinary point and sidebar, but I do love to ski, but I promise I won't say that's my story when we meet up. One last question for you, because I've seen it a few times, is BlackRock hiring for other marketers right now?
We're hiring, let's see. So right now we're hiring for data science. We're hiring in the content division. So we've expanded in social media, and we're going to continue to expand in social media. It was one of my personal breakthroughs here because, when we first came on board, compliance was said, look, social media, it's a little tricky for us out there. You might not want to do that. But Una Neri, who is in compliance, runs compliance here, was an incredible partner and helped us figure out how do we find our place. We found our place. We're going hard. And LinkedIn is one of the key platforms for us. And so we're hiring aggressively in that area.
That's awesome. Yeah, no, LinkedIn in my mind is a perfect place for y'all to play. And I think also, this is sounds like a very specific thing, but I think, being someone that worked at a financial services firm and understanding that compliance is one of the fastest growing divisions in every financial services company, the CMO and honestly most senior leaders having a close and strong relationship with those who run compliance is like incredibly important. It's in, at least from my perspective, it's how you get anything done.
It is so true. And some people set up an antagonistic relationship with compliance. No, it's not that they're going to say yes to you all the time, but they will help you provided that you show them that you understand the risk. The second partner that people don't think about is the CFO. I said I start from the economics of the business. In every company I've been in, the CFO has been kind of the greatest source of illumination for me. This is how we make money. This is what matters to the street. Can you translate what you do into that?
Totally. Yeah. Just before we move on to the rapid fire, I think, in so much of what you've said, it just seems like there's been a lot of intention in what you've done and spent a lot of time. We have this thing at Morning Brew called Sponge Week, where when new hires join the team, they're just sponges, sponging in as much information as possible in the beginning to do good work. And it seems like a lot of what you've done is not just be a sponge of the company, but understanding the business you're in, understanding people's actual experiences with the business. And I think that discovery has led you to build a lot of the foundational elements you need to get from inning three to inning nine.
Yes, 100%. And I hope you're right because, any top of the third is still a long way to go, right?
For sure. It means a lot of opportunity. So we're going to finish up with a rapid fire. Only rule is you have to answer with one word to one sentence. If you go over a sentence, I'm going to cut you off. Ready to do it?
Okay.
Who is your favorite follow on Twitter or LinkedIn or whatever your favorite social media platform of choice is?
I don't really have one. I'm random as random can be.
Really?
And it may show you kind of, my life pattern. That's it.
Okay. Sweet. What is your favorite book since January?
Oh, Angela Duckworth, Grit, Power of Passion and Perseverance.
Love that. Since you're a music guy, this is the first time we're asking this in the rapid fire. Who are you listening to right now?
Oh my God. That's so hard. I actually went back in time. I'm listening to Steely Dan.
Love that.
Yeah, I went back in
time. What is the marketing word that pisses you off the most? That is like the most cliche, annoying word to hear.
Oh my God. I have so many. because I hate marketing jargon. I hate it. Yeah. But I'm going to go with something that's probably beyond marketing. I'm going to go with digital marketing. It's so imprecise.
Yeah. And also digital marketing is marketing.
It's redundant at this point. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Last three. How do you take your coffee?
Oh, black, no sugar, no cream.
My co-founder Austin would love you. He's a black coffee, nothing else guy. You put anything else in, he thinks it's sacrilegious to coffee.
I'm rocking with him on that one.
Second to last, what is the thing you do in the morning for you to have your most productive day?
Easy. If I do it, stretch and run, and then read something that that has nothing to do with news or marketing.
Yeah, that last one that you just said, I've found in recent months that makes a massive difference in like getting the day going with momentum and just like creative thinking outside of what you do.
Yeah.
I love that. Last question, and I just added this in because it's going to be fun. What does Frank Cooper want to be when he grows up?
Oh, wow. You know what? I want to be I want to be an executive who grows other people. And the reason it's just longer than a sentence is because what I found is that no matter what you do in your career, no matter what you do, over time that fades. The only thing that doesn't fade is the people that you help. And so I measure my success by how many people I've helped and by how much. That's it.
I love that. Frank Cooper, thank you so much for the time and the insights. Love the conversation. Just an absolute wealth of knowledge. Really appreciate it.
And it's a blast. Appreciate it, Alex. I'll talk to you soon. Nice to
meet you. Grab coffee soon. Take it easy.
All right now. Okay.
And thank you everyone for joining the CMO series. What incredible wisdom from Frank Cooper, CMO of BlackRock. As always, the CMO series, 2 days a week, Tuesdays and Thursdays. We'll be back on Thursday. But thank you all for joining. These will be available to rewatch. We've recorded all of them and we'll let you know how you can watch them. But thanks everyone for joining and hope you have a great rest of your day and your week. Thanks everyone.
And when I wake up, I recognize you looking at me for the pay cut. But how must I be looking at you from the face down? One Mac 11, even room with the bass down. Scheming, and let me tell you about my life. Painkillers only put me in.